I feel led to speak a few minutes on a scripture that's so meaningful to every Christian. It's six short sentences, 120 words, and these 14 promises made to the believer. And the scripture I'm talking about is the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. He prepareth a table before me in the presence of my enemy. He anointeth my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. For the next few minutes, I'd like for us to keep in mind the first five words of the psalm. If it were not for the first five words, the other 115 could not have been spoken. The psalmist believed in a personal Lord. He knew without a shadow of a doubt that the Lord was his. And he spoke these words out of a heart of assurance. And because of that assurance, he could claim the rest of the psalm. And this morning, you and I, if we can say out of a heart of assurance, the Lord is my shepherd, then we too can claim the 23rd Psalm. Amen. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. The child of God shall not want any good thing. The young lions do lack and suffer hunger, but they that seek the Lord shall not want any good thing. The doctrine of no want to the believer is one of the clearest, most comprehensive declarations of Scripture. In view of the simple promises that God makes to his children, the only excuse that they could have for not receiving it is unbelief. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. The good shepherd leads the sheep to green pastures. They lie down in tall, tender green grass, fully fed and satisfied. Can you and I lay down tonight, fully fed and satisfied on God's word, and can say out of a heart of assurance, the Lord is my shepherd, then we too can claim the promises of the 23rd Psalm. He leadeth me beside the still waters. This is a place of rest and comfort and peace. To be led beside still waters, deep, not stagnant, not stormy, but a place of peace and quiet that you or I can go and be with the Lord to meditate and to tell him and thank him for all of the blessings that he has bestowed upon you during your lifetime, and just tell him what your needs and what your wants are. And if you can say out of a heart of assurance, the Lord is my shepherd, then you can have it. John 14, verse 14, talking to the child of God, says, anything you ask in my name, I will do it. And he will. He will keep his promises. And after he does this for us, he does something else for me. He restoreth my soul. If we fail, stumble, or fall away, if we neglect and get back into sin, he's faithful and just. He wants us to repent, and he will chasten us till we do confess and repent, so he can restore our soul. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. And after he does that, there's something else that he wants us to do. What was it Jesus told the lady at the well when she was forgiven? He said to go and sin no more. And that's what he wants us to do, is to go and sin no more. But if we should, he's faithful and just, if we ask for forgiveness, to forgive us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. And a Christian, I don't believe, can sin without knowing it. And if we commit a death sin, we need to take care of that quick and not let it prolong day in and day out and keep adding to it. And the reason we need to take care of it quick, we are not promised tomorrow. And if death should come, the Bible tells us the condition that we're in, we shall forever be. And that's why we need to keep a clean slate and be able to say each day, the Lord is my shepherd. And after he has done this for us, he leads us in the paths of righteousness. And why does he do that? He does that to keep our soul pure and perfect. And if we pass through the paths of righteousness, then we will be forgiven and have life eternal in the Lord's house forever. And after he has restored our soul, he does something else for us in the paths of righteousness. When we become a Christian, we are God's child by birth, the new birth. And I was born into the Roberts family, and my earthly father did not want me to disgrace his name, and neither does my heavenly father want me to disgrace his name. Therefore, he leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake, for his own sake, that he might be honored. In view of the simple promises, the only thing that would keep a Christian from having all of his wants and needs met is unbelief. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. When we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, God is our protector, our comforter. He watches over and takes care of us during that time. And in that part of the world, there was mountains and valleys and rocky places and dangerous places. And people walk long distances from one place to another. Today we have nice cars that we can drive and go long distances quick. But in that day, people had to walk long distances through the valleys of the mountains, and they were wild animals that many times would come out and would kill the people walking through the valley. And what was it David said? Yea, though I walk through the valley of death. No, he didn't say that. He said the valley of the shadow of death. Sinners die. Yes, they die eternally. Christians pass from death unto life. They pass through the shadow of death. And they move at the time of physical death. They move to the Lord's house to be forever with the Lord. In the mansion that Jesus said he had gone to prepare for us. And I think of our highways today being our valley of the shadow of death, because there's so many people killed on the highways. Last Wednesday we went to Gainesville, and there's a big sign across the northbound lanes, and it said that already this year 530 people had been killed on the highways just in the state of Georgia. Think about the other 49 states in the world, how many people that's killed on our roads. And I think of that as our valley of the shadow of death. And like I said in the prayer, God has promised in Psalms 121 verse 8 that he will protect our going out and coming in, now and forever. And we need to be able to say each day, the Lord is my shepherd. And he will watch over and protect us during that time. And thank God for the staff and the rod and the staff. The rod of Jesus Christ and the staff of the Holy Spirit that leads and guides us and fills out the way in dangerous places, watches over and protects us each day. And he prepares a table before us in the presence of our enemy. Thank God for a prepared table. And he prepares it for us in the presence of our enemy. They cannot keep him from it. They are compelled to look on and to see how God intercedes and watches over and takes care of that which is his. If God be for us, then who could be against us? Amen. He prepareth the table before me. He anointeth my head with oil. My cup runneth over. In the scripture, oil refers to the Holy Spirit. And if our heads are anointed in oil, then we have the fruits of the Spirit, which is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, meekness, temperance. And Peter explained it this way, joy unspeakable and full of glory. John said it was our spiritual birthright to have full joy. No wonder David said, my cup runneth over, whose wouldn't? Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. We think of this, of the Lord watching over and taking care of us each day. But you know, one of them days is going to be the last day. And on the last day, if we can say out of a heart of assurance, the Lord is my shepherd, and we have held fast our first confidence and rejoicing, firm unto the end, we'll move through the stores of heaven to the Lord's house. And when we die physically, the soul and the spirit is the part that's alive. And we move out of this body we leave our body and our clothes and move to the Lord's house to be forever with the Lord. Jesus said that in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I'll come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And Jesus is not going to be living in a room. He's going to be living in a mansion. And he said, where I'm at, ye may be also. And I'm going to believe Jesus, and I'm going to believe that we'll be living in a mansion instead of a room. I'm going to believe what Jesus says about that. And while we're talking about heaven, today there's people that tells us that we go to heaven without clothes on. And I guess the reason they say that is when we die, we move out and leave our clothes and everything here. But I want to quote a few scriptures in Revelations. John, when Christ appeared to him on the Isle of Patmos, he was told to write 7 letters to 7 local pastors, to 7 congregation of believers, and told him what to write. And he had wrote 6 letters, and then Christ told him to write the 7th letter to the church of Laodicea, and John did. He wrote just exactly what Jesus told him to, and when he wrote the letter, the last one, he looked around for his other instructions, and Jesus was gone. He was not there. And in looking for him, he looked up to heaven, and there was a door open in heaven, and there was a voice came through the door like a trumpet and said, come up hither, and I will show thee things that'll be after these things. And the voice he heard was the same voice that had spoke with him all the time to write the letters. And when John went through the door into heaven, he saw a throne set. And he that sat upon the throne was to look upon like a jasper and a sardine stone. And around and about the throne was 24 seats. And on the seats sat 24 elders. They had just been resurrected from the earth. Chapter 4 of Revelation's on is after the rapture of the church that we're looking for. And the 24 elders was dressed in white with a gold crown on their head. And then in Revelation's chapter 6, verse 9, 10, and 11, there was a multitude of people that showed up in heaven, and someone said, who are all of these? And another said, these are they that came out of the great tribulation. And white robes were given to every one of them. And in Revelation's chapter 14, it talks about the 144,000, the 12 tribes of Israel that appeared into heaven. That's during the first 42 months of Daniel's 70th week. And they appeared into heaven. They was translated from the earth to heaven. And they was dressed in white linen. And each one of them had a harp. And I say this to tell you this. When we get to heaven, you're going to have on clothes. And you're going to be dressed in white. Thank you, God, for your word, for Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Garland. Really well prepared. Mary's sermon touched all of our hearts, I'm sure. Thank you to Jesus, God, for placing the words in your heart. We're going to conclude.